upstairs at Froelich's. Show 312, Reel 1.
Ice cream. You scream, we all scream for ice cream. Well, no, that's bad. Ice cream. You scream, we all scream for ice cream. You understand it? I scream, you scream, we all scream for ice cream. Ice cream, you scream, we all scream for ice cream.
Jim Jarmusch, the big Jim Jarmusch here.
Yeah, Jim Jarmusch, Shumush.
we just watched Night on Earth last night, and because I didn't have subtitles on the fucking thing, we couldn't understand half the movie.
I was gonna tell you this. I was gonna hold it until the episode, but this is perfect seguing. That copy of fucking Mystery Train you gave me didn't have subtitles,
so you couldn't understand a damn thing the Japanese people were saying.
But thank you for YouTube. YouTube had it, and it had closed captionings, and I was able to watch that part.
What was funny was I didn't really need the subtitles to know what they were talking about. I knew what they were talking about. They kept saying, Elvis, Carl Parkins. I knew what they were arguing about, and also, I liked it being a mystery. But we'll get to Mystery Train. Hey, Mystery Train, how about that? Right after we finish on Down by Law. So we're talking about the two movies that Jim Jarmusch made between 1986 and 1989. Down by Law, starring John Lurie, Tom Waits, and a Roberto Benigni.
Roberto! I use up all of my English.
Ice cream, you scream, we all scream.
We all scream for ice cream.
And then Mystery Train, which has a bunch of people in it, namely Steve Buscemi. Screamin Jay Hawkins, for crying out loud, Cinqué Lee.
Dude, fucking Joe Strummer, man.
Joe Strummer and Vondi Curtis Hall in that movie, kind of an anthology, different from Down by Law. So I want to start off by telling you why I wanted to do Jim Jarmusch, because we started watching Jim Jarmusch movies, and we've been doing it every Sunday. And a couple of weeks back, we watched Strangers in Paradise, which was his first movie, made in 1984, black and white. And I really, really, really enjoy it. But it's just basically, just sort of put it in your head. This is what the movie is. This is how he makes the movie. Just one wide shot. And it's just one take. And then a black screen. And then another scene with one long wide shot. And then he keeps the movie. He keeps doing this with the movie throughout it. And that's how he tells the story. And then...
Yeah.
It gets a lot of notice. It's kind of made for no money and everything. Gets him a lot of notice, plays in film festivals and all that stuff. So he does Down by Law 2 years later, which is another black and white movie. Just beautiful. It looks so good, though.
That was the comment or the compliment I was going to pay to that movie. Even though it was shot in black and white, you couldn't tell me that movie was shot for like a little over a half a million. Because yeah. I think he is such a talented filmmaker. To where he made that look like that movie was actually a couple of million dollars.
Yeah, it had really good production value. Probably excellent because he was running around with a camera, just focusing on his three leads. And they're names for the most part. I mean, John Lurie isn't really a name. He's more of a musician. And he was the lead character in Stranger Than Paradise and a friend of his. But he brings in Tom Waits, who is like a big star, as we know. And he has Roberto Benigni, who was a very big star in Europe. He wasn't quite a household name yet. Not until...
He didn't even become a household name until 11 years later.
Yeah, yeah. But he was the son of the Pink Panther. You remember that?
Yeah, but didn't that come out after Down by Law?
I'm not really sure.
I think it did. I think it did. Because he played a different version of Clouseau.
Right. I don't know where get that idea that they should have him in the role. But he is very interesting. And then, so Down by Law is a very interesting movie, too, because you create, like, basically, you spend a lot of time creating the first two characters, which are John Lurie and Tom Waits, and they're both in jail. They're both thrown in jail wrongfully, even though they are kind of horrible, you know?
Well, yeah, but I'd say Tom Waits a little less horrible. He's just a fucking drunk degenerate who ain't doing shit with his life versus a fucking pimp.
Yeah, John Lurie is a pimp, he is entrapped. He is entrapped with an underage girl, gets thrown in jail. Tom Waits is arrested for having a dead body in a car that he's driving. So both of these guys are dupes.
And they were set up. And that, you see, now there's my one little problem with this movie. Again, a little problem, but this is Jim Jarmusch, so I'm gonna let it go.
Right.
Why? Why were they set up?
It could be this kind of, I don't know, existential nightmare, if you will. Maybe people who are just punished and they don't know why. Maybe they're treated badly because they treat other people badly. Maybe these are questions we shouldn't be asking.
Like I said, it's a Jim Jarmusch movie, so we got to forgive it. It sins a little bit here, but
you mean what are the coincidences that these two guys and Roberto would wind up in the same cell at some point?
Well, then Roberto, like you said, it was
Roberto's the only one who's guilty. He's the only one technically guilty of what he did. He in self defense, they threw pool balls. Sorry, are they balls? God damn it. Where's my tequila? They threw pool balls at him. He throws one, kills a guy. It's just by accident, you know? And the way he tells the story, you wouldn't believe that this guy could harm a fly. He's like, I throw the ball, he kills him. He's very loud. He's very loud with his Italian accent, you know?
Yeah, it's way, way up there. I mean, how did this guy win a fucking Oscar? How did he win two I want to know how he won two fucking Oscars.
I don't, you know, I did not want to see Life is Beautiful because I'm not interested in a movie about uplifting spirituality in a concentration camp, you know?
I mean, let me tell you something right now, man. I liked that movie a lot when it came out, and it took me by surprise. I'm not going to go as far as to say Roberto should have gotten Best Actor, but it was a better movie than I thought it was going to be.
People, friends of mine always make the joke about the best scene in the movie being the last one.
it's evil. Come on, man.
It's fucked up is what it is. But it was interesting when he goes up and he gets his Academy Award and he climbs over the chairs and he walks up to the stage and he's like, I love you all. I want to make love to all of you.
Yeah, pretty much. And then, of course, my favorite line, like the one they use in The Simpsons, I use up all of my English.
I just have to go. Okay, so they first, Waits and Lurie are in jail. They're at each other's throats. They're getting on each other's nerves. Roberto comes in. He provides this weird, unusual balance for them because they're always fighting. Tom Waits and John Lurie, they're always fighting and wrestling. And
then Bob fucking just gets them. He's like the balance. You know what I mean?
I guess he is. For that, he's always breaking it together. Up. For some reason, it's never explained, but they managed to escape from prison because I guess Roberto
Bob says he finds a way in the yard to escape. Bob found a way to escape in the yard.
Right. And then they do.
And I mean, they don't show these. Okay, dude, this is a movie made for a little under $1 million. Of course, you're not going to have the money to show the escape, but they imply the escape. You know what I mean?
They imply it. And then we're in swamps and we're going through the swamps. We're in a boat. The boat sinks. They wind up out in the open road. They wind up in a restaurant, something. That just
Louisiana. Now that's what got me. I'm sorry. Now that right there,
it's Italian.
I already knew where it was going to go. Bad casting decision, because you know it says in the opening credits the Nicolaudi, the Italian lady,
Nicoletta.
You know that when you get to that scene, Roberto is going to be going up to her. She's Italian. They're going to hit it off, and he's going to stay there.
Played by his real life wife.
Who would become his real life wife? They weren't married yet.
Yeah, they got married in 91.
But I mean, it's just, that's just the cast, like, knowing. I mean, yeah, it's cool. We know Roberto's going to have the better ending compared to the other two guys.
Well, the other two guys, it's weird, too. It doesn't seem as though Roberto is some kind of a mythological figure to them.
He's almost like...
They are the ones who separate at the end, you know, the two roads that fork, and they say goodbye. They make their goodbyes, but he stays with this girl.
He could almost be considered like a Jiminy Cricket type character.
He kind of looks like him, too.
Yeah, and especially when he's cooking that fucking rabbit. he's all crouched down there like Cricket.
He kind of reminds me of like an Italian Woody Allen or something.
A lot of people have said that about him. Well, you're not, like, for some reason, that's not the first time I've heard that.
Yeah, he has this kind of like, because he plays a character in Night on Earth. I couldn't understand most of the dialogue he was saying because it was in Italian. But he plays a cab driver who takes a priest into his car, and he decides to confess his sins. So he's telling this whole story about all these women he had sex with and how he cheated on his own brother-in-law with his brother-in-law's wife. The priest tries to take nitro pills because he has a heart condition, but the nitro pills fall out of his hand. He drops dead of a heart attack in the back of his cab while Roberto is telling this incredibly lurid story, and he's doing all these hand motions about how he was having sex with this woman. And then he takes him out of his cab, leaves him in a park, and just drives off.
Maybe I should check this movie out. Sounds interesting.
Well, it's you know, I mean, like, if you can understand what the fuck. The best, my favorite, it's about five different cab rides across the world.
So it's an anthology film.
It's another anthology, sort of like Mystery Train, except completely separated. Maybe the only difference being that they take place during the same night. But first we start in L.A., Winona Ryder is a cab driver. She takes Jenna Rollins to her house in Beverly Hills. Then we go to New York, and Armin Mueller-Stahl is the cab driver, and he takes Giancarlo Esposito to Brooklyn, man. And they pick up Rosie Perez, who is Giancarlo's, I guess, girlfriend at the time. And that's my favorite story. The New York story is my favorite one. Then we go to Paris, and a blind woman gets into a cab, and then we're in Rome, I think, with Roberto Benigni. And then we go to Helsinki. So it's like five different stories, five different cab drivers. We're going to probably watch Dead Man next week because that's the next movie in the Jarmusch series. And Dead Man,
I like that movie.
That's
a
movie I really love. I love it for the storytelling, the cinematography, and the cast.
You know what's funny is a lot of people dog Dead Man, and I don't. I think it's Jarmusch's best film, mainly because it's probably the most coherent film that he's done.
Well, maybe it's the most familiar narrative.
Yeah, like it just seems like it's a movie that it was just like, it was easily accessible by anybody. Even though it was shot in black and white, you had a big enough star attached to it.
Well, we are going to see The Dead Don't Die. If you've seen it, don't ruin it for me.
I haven't seen it yet. I heard it was very mixed.
I just got to see what Jarmusch can do with a zombie film. But I do enjoy Dead Man. I really like Ghost Dog, though. Ghost Dog was fantastic.
Ghost Dog's a really good movie.
And I, for different reasons, I really like Stranger Than Paradise, just because it was just such a different way to tell a story. But I was asking my wife the other day, I was like, which do you prefer, Down by Law or Mystery Train? She said Down by Law. She preferred Down by Law over Mystery Train.
Good. I'm glad me and your wife agreed, because I did actually prefer Down by Law to Mystery Train. It seemed like even though Mystery Train was an anthology story, I think the story in Down by Law was a little more focused.
So, you know, okay, we wind up at this weird kind of Italian restaurant in the middle of fucking Louisiana, run by an Italian woman with unshaved armpits. Like, she's always going to have, apparently, it's like a thing in Italy, you have unshaved armpits.
Hey, they carry that over to the next movie, too.
They do,
we'll get
yes.
into that. They do. They carry that do. Over.
Anyway, Roberto falls in love with Nicoletta, and they fall in love in real life a few years later, I think.
They're still married.
It's a very charming. It's a very charming story, and I only wish that the only thing I wished was that Tom Waits and John Lurie would become real friends by the end. But it's not really that kind of a movie, I guess. It's just basically.
But I like the quiet.
It's a marriage of convenience in a way.
Yeah, I like the quiet friendship nods they give each other when they take each fork.
I would say. But it's interesting because those characters really kind of mean a lot to me, even though I know very little about them and probably wouldn't like them if I knew them in real life.
Yeah, Roberto would probably be that one guy at the party you'd want to avoid.
I mean, I love the whole ice cream, you scream. We were all howling at that when he was doing that in prison. It was just wonderful. I love those little moments of natural, because it doesn't seem like something scripted. It felt like something just like, I only know a little bit of English. Well, what do you know? I scream, you scream, we all scream, you know.
He just did something a little off the damn cuff just to get a good scene out of him, I guess. He goes, hey, Roberto, do something. Get a good scene in.
All right.
And I guess, and I hate to say this, I guess the one reason I really did like the movie a lot was because of Roberto. Because
of Roberto being
I like him as a person. I really do.
I like Tom Waits. He's so Tom Waits is my guy. I love Tom Waits.
I love him too, man.
He's fantastic.
I mean, a great songwriter, phenomenal songwriter, and an even better actor. Yeah, he's such a good actor.
There's a lot of Tom Waits music in Jim Jarmusch movies, so when we put on, because he has two songs on the Night on Earth soundtrack, and every time Regan hears his voice, you know how he sounds. He's got that kind of voice when he sings like this. And she's like, how can he sing like that? And it's just like the way he is.
Yeah, it's the way he is. But people also love him for it, man.
He's the same guy who did the music for One from the Heart, which was
One from the Heart.
The only good thing about that movie was the music. All right, let's move on.
But then speaking of music,
we got some dancing to do, don't we?
Yeah.
We got some... We got some Elvis over here and a little bit of Carl Parkins.
And a little bit of The Killer, Jerry Lee.
Jerry Lee. This is Memphis, and this is the Memphis I remember, okay? Because we lived in Tennessee for about a year because I had family down there. My mother had family down there. She was born in Nashville. We did drive through Memphis. Memphis was a shithole back then. Memphis doesn't look like that anymore, by the way. It's all cleaned up. It's all been gentrified. And Sun Studios doesn't exist anymore. It's kind of sad. This was the birthplace of rock and roll, not Cleveland, fucking Ohio. I don't care that a bunch of people who became famous in rock and roll came from Cleveland. No, it came from Memphis, dude.
Because he was the king and everyone else is schmucks compared to him.
We know technically he was born in Tupelo, but he did move to Memphis. But this is Mystery Train. It was made in 1989. Features an internationally cast that will leave you bilingually tortured, but only for the first, really for this first part, which is probably my favorite, actually my favorite story. We got three stories in the movie, and I wanted to ask you, do you think this influenced Quentin Tarantino? Because I'm going to give a big resounding yes.
Oh yeah,
this movie like was enormously influential to Tarantino.
Yeah, the type of storytelling, the anthology style storytelling. The main catalyst is that gunshot.
Yeah.
You know, because everyone, like, you hear the gunshot twice, and then eventually you know you're going to get to that gunshot where it came from.
Yeah, because the first time you hear it is with the Japanese couple, right?
Yep.
They're trying to close their briefcase and leave. You hear this, and you're like, that sounded like a gunshot. What was that? And then you hear it again in the second story, and then you're like, oh, that was a gunshot.
And even the Japanese girl says, oh, it sounds like a 38, or it was the guy. Each one said, it sounded like a 38.
And he says, "And he says, this is America," which is funny. So you have three different stories all taking place in Memphis. The first story is about a young Japanese couple that, I guess, love rock and roll, and they want to see the place of Elvis. They want to see the place. They argue constantly about who made more of an impact on rock and roll, Elvis or Carl Perkins. Thing is, Elvis sang songs that were written by Carl Perkins. The two of them had a friendship. Elvis was visually more appealing than Carl Perkins, so he popularized it. And he also, it's not really widely talked about, but a lot of people thought Elvis was black. So they thought he was a white man singing black music. And well, I think they talk about it too in Mystery Train.
Oh yeah, not uncommon back in those days. A lot of people thought that.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of people thought that about Jerry Lee Lewis when they first heard him.
Yeah, so it's sort of like taking this music form that was already well established and just sort of mainstreaming it and then making shitloads of money off of it. I mean, this changed music. That whole thing was the birth of all music, really. Birth of all modern music, as you hear it.
Yeah, modern music. Pop music, yeah. If you were.
And then leading into hard rock and heavy metal and all that shit. And then you're fucking Disturbed and...
Five finger death punch.
You know, all of it goes back to Elvis. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
So the first story is about these Japanese tourists. They go and take a tour of Sun Studios. They argue. They have sex. She puts like lipstick on her face and then kisses him, and he's got like his clown lipstick on his face.
Yeah,
it's hilarious.
And then the whole thing, how they share cigarettes, how they share a single cigarette.
They share each a time cigarette. Yeah. One of the more interesting things was, although my wife filled me in on this, when I think Cinqué Lee is asking for a tip, they give him a plum.
Yeah.
And my wife told me because her mother spent a lot of time in Japan as a young girl because her dad was in the army in the war. It's customary for Japanese people to give gifts. They don't give tips. They give gifts. So that's why she gave him the plum. And then Screamin Jay Hawkins takes the plum and eats it, which was hilarious to me. So they spend a little bit of time.
I do like the first story. It's just...
Plus, I thought she was adorable. And he was always... Yeah. She always seemed to be such a ray of sunshine and so happy and smiling. And she...
I just don't know why her man was always such a Debbie Downer.
He was a glum. He was very glum.
Yeah.
Like, and also the way he was dressed. Like, I mean, that, man. You know, his hair was kind of greased. He kind of looked retro. He had this retro look about him.
He had raised shoes. You notice that he had raised soles on his shoes to make him look taller.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So then we move on. They leave. And then we get into our second story, which is this woman, again, Nicoletta, who... is there to, I guess, claim a body or pick up a body?
Yeah, and then she gets held over for a night in Memphis. She has to stay there for a night.
She gets stuck. I mean, but the thing is, she's Italian, so she doesn't really know the language. She doesn't know that people are out to just get her money because she's got a lot of money, right? The guy at the newsstand sells her all the shitload of magazines that she'll never read, that she won't be able to read. And then Tom Noonan shows up and tells her the story in a diner about Elvis's ghost and a comb. And then he tries to scam more money off of her later. She gets the hell out of there, luckily. Finds herself at the hotel.
Well, I like what she says to him. She goes, here's $10 for the story, and here's $10 to leave me alone.
Yeah. And she tells him she doesn't believe that story for a second.
And then you think that she's going to fucking get raped when she walks out of that diner.
Yeah.
But then out of nowhere, she goes to the hotel. Now, what gets me is no one decided to follow her. Those guys didn't decide to follow her to the hotel?
Well, maybe they were looking out for the next mark. You know, another chump that they could scam money out of or something like that.
I guess.
Luckily, she gets out of it. I mean, Jarmusch doesn't really tell stories like that. He doesn't really get nasty. There's a certain naivete or an innocence about the characters, even as they might be doing, you know, terrible things. Like,
right,
we're going to find out in the third installment. She winds up in a hotel. She shares a room with a woman who doesn't have any money. That woman is connected to one of the characters in the third story.
Yep.
And they share a room, and this woman is telling her whole life story. And I forgot what most of her life story was about. I think it was about her boyfriend or something like that.
Yeah, about how he's just like...
It's supposed to be Joe Strummer? Or
yeah, Joe Strummer. Guy? Joe Strummer.
They go to bed, and then Nicoletta sees Elvis's ghost. And he's like, excuse me, I shouldn't be here right now. You know?
That scene was just so... I get why it was there, but it was just like, what the fuck?
I'm gonna take off
next
now.
And then the next morning, she didn't even sleep the night before.
No, she was up the whole night because it was fucking Elvis's ghost, for crying out loud. He's standing over by. Oh, and the train goes by. We keep getting these cues about time passing because we get the train going by, and then we hear a gunshot. You know, they get
and then they hear it, and then they're just like, eh, fuck it, and they go. Dee Dee? She's passed out. I think it's Oh, wait, no, they both hear the gunshot at the same time. That's right.
Yeah, they
then
do.
Then Dee Dee goes to sleep.
It's in the morning, the gunshot.
Oh, yeah, you're right. You're absolutely right.
You know what?
Dee Dee and Nicoletta hear the Japanese people screwing next door.
Oh, yeah, too. That, too. It sort of connects. You know what? This is like a better version of Four Rooms. You remember Four Rooms? I think it's a better version of that.
So what you're trying to say is Tarantino ripped off Jarmusch and forever, because what you're saying is Four Rooms was an offshoot of Mystery Train.
Well, Four Rooms was a ripoff of Mystery Train. I don't know about that.
Yeah.
I mean, it was like different filmmakers and they were all telling different stories. Some parts were kind of funny. Some parts were stupid. There's a lot. The only short film that I really liked from Four Rooms, I think, was Robert Rodriguez's.
I like Tarantino's, even though it's a Twilight Zone ripoff.
It's a ripoff of Twilight, or Alfred Hitchcock, actually.
Okay, well,
The Man from Rio with Peter Lorre and Steve McQueen, I think. But that final story was just, it was only there just so they chopped off the guy's hand, you know, the finger rather.
But I like Tarantino in that story.
Setup for this lighter, and then the lighter doesn't light, and then he chops off the finger, and then he takes the money and leaves. And then that's it. I mean, and they're screaming in blood. That whole thing was just a gag to set up for that final shot.
But it was such a funny.
Anyway, the kids.
But yeah,
from
so we're
Rodriguez.
We're back to the girls. Room. They're in the room, and then they wake up the next morning, and then...
they also, yeah, they part ways, and then we get, I guess, what might be the origin of the gunshot, with, I guess, Joe Strummer and Vondie Curtis Harrell.
And Steve Buscemi.
Well, first, and it's those two. They're talking. He got laid off or something like that. He lost his job. Hates Elvis. Everybody loves Elvis in Memphis, but he hates Elvis. He gets drunk and rowdy. He's like he's either going to get his ass kicked or he's going to get into a lot of trouble. Vondie Curtis Hall calls Rick Aviles. Rick Aviles comes to pick him up. Then they go and they pick up Steve Buscemi because he's his brother-in-law, even though he really isn't his brother-in-law. It's established later on, right?
Yep, it's established.
They go to a liquor store and they shoot the liquor store owner for using the N-word, you know, basically.
Yeah, basically say effing N-words, you know, you got to always watch him. And then he had no idea that he was with him, you know what I mean?
And then
that's
why
he got shot.
He shoots him. Who shoots him? Joe Strummer?
Yeah, Joe Strummer shoots him. But the guy ends up surviving, from what I understand.
So they need a place to lay low, so they go to the hotel where Screamin' Jay Hawkins
is. Also, we got to say that character was played by Rockets Red Glare, who was also in Down by Law.
Rockets Red Glare was, yes, he was in a bunch of Jim Jarmusch movies. I think he's in Stranger Than Paradise, too.
Yep. Must be a friend. The quote-unquote, and no pun intended, biggest role he ever got was the hotel clerk in Tom Hanks' Big.
And he was also in After Hours. Martin Scorsese.
Oh, Scorsese. Yep, there you go. Another big
role. I think he's the bouncer, and he says, well, tonight's Mohawk night. If you had a Mohawk, I could let you in. Which is like one of my favorite lines from a movie ever. Rockets Red Glare also may have killed Nancy Spungen. We don't know that for a fact, but he was the very last person to see Nancy Spungen alive.
Oh,
and
okay.
He's not with us anymore, but he had often joked about killing Nancy Spungen.
Well, can't do nothing now. He did.
He did a lot of heroin is what he did. They need to lay low. They hang out in a really shitty room, room 22, I guess. And it's,
yeah, because there ain't nothing in there. It's unfinished. It's just
this
like,
is a really, really, I mean, like this hotel, if you leave this hotel, you'll want to go get a shower immediately, you know? It makes you feel disgusting even looking at it.
And I like how they try to have the bellhop look like a standard bellhop, even though the whole hotel is like this gigantic.
Yeah,
piece
I know. It's
of
right.
Shit.
He's got the tipped hat. That's why I was thinking Tim Roth in Four Rooms. He reminded me of that.
And I like how Nicoletta actually gave him a good tip and said, hey, I like your hat.
So then
you get to that second story, that one threw me for a loop because I honestly thought like all it is them getting drunk and yeah. trying to elude capture from the police. You wake up the next morning, Joe Strummer's got the gun in his hand, and like you actually think that gunshot is going to be him blowing his fucking head off.
I thought it was.
Dude, it was Jarmusch. It wouldn't have shocked me in the least.
I don't know.
Like,
Jarmusch like... doesn't really do that, though. But again, he doesn't really operate that way. There's something crude about the way he makes a movie, but he's also has this kind of innocence about him, you know?
Well, there's also that, and then there's the Steve Buscemi effect. Usually if you have Steve Buscemi in a movie, he's the one that's going to get fucking
shot. Someone's going to get shot in the face. Why the fuck did you do that, man? You know?
So exactly. And it's just like when you see that Steve Buscemi gets shot, all he does is he looks up and he says, you shot me. I can't believe you fucking shot me.
You're not even my brother-in-law and you shot me.
Yes, you know, you're not even my brother-in-law and you shot me. It's the, if that existed just to give that deadpan, and that's the thing with Jim Jarmusch, it's always deadpan. You had to give that deadpan Steve Buscemi delivery. When he fucking gets shot in the kneecap.
It's also where you have, like, say, Barton Fink. In the movie Barton Fink, Steve Buscemi plays a bellhop in a horrible hotel that's falling apart. So, and it's all these, a lot of this sort of connects. It's a weird thing. You could probably watch this movie, Mystery Train, and you could watch Barton Fink, and you could watch Four Rooms altogether. Still, I think this is the best of the three. I mean, Barton Fink I do enjoy, but not as much. It's not my favorite Coen Brothers film.
I have yet to watch Barton Fink.
It's about a lunatic guy writer. John Turturro plays a writer, and he's trying to write this stupid low-budget wrestling movie. And so he takes a hotel, and his next-door neighbor in the hotel is John Goodman, who may or may not be a serial killer.
Oh, jeez.
And there's
okay,
mosquitoes.
That's enough of that. That's enough of that. The other movie I haven't seen, believe it or not, is Miller's Crossing.
Miller's Crossing is a great film. Great film. Got to see it. See it!
Christ okay, sake. I will.
What the fuck is
I
wrong
will.
With you? I'm sorry, I'm in Martin Scorsese mode because we were watching Martin Scorsese movies all last week. And we watched Mean Streets on Friday, and I kept telling Regan, I go, what's the matter with you? What's the matter with you? And she was just like, you know, she wasn't having it. We watched, like I said, I told you, we watched Shutter Island. So I was like, fuck this. Let's do a whole bunch of Scorsese. So we watched Taxi Driver.
Oh, because you had to cleanse your palate after watching Shutter Island, right?
Well, I mean, it's kind of weird. We were thinking about this. There's this dynamic. There's this raw energy. There's this violence and unpredictability of early Scorsese. And then you look at a movie that has been so storyboarded and planned, like Shutter Island. It's just...
Well, let me tell you this. You know what I watched last night after them two Jim Jarmusch movies?
Hmm? What?
Had to watch Wolf of Wall Street.
You know, I have yet to see that.
Are you fucking kidding me?
I haven't gotten around. I'm sorry. I was busy raising a baby at the time. I didn't have time. I'll get to it.
Okay, I'll at least say this. That movie came out my first year of marriage, and my wife wasn't pregnant yet. At least I don't think she was.
Mm-hmm.
So, or she was just pregnant when Wolf of Wall Street came out. So I had plenty of time to see that.
So you had time to really get into it.
We had to
shut down our lives when our baby was born. There was just no, because we had no help. We had virtually no help.
Oh, but well, anyway. I mean, we got my mom. But anyway, like, back to this. I mean, Mystery Train, at the end of the day, I mean, the whole resolution in the movie is you do actually get to see what happens to everybody, which I think is good. Unlike the prior movie, which their fate, the ending is ambiguous. You don't know what's going to happen to them. They just leave it up
in the air. In this one, Joe Strummer's gun, I guess, it accidentally shoots Steve Buscemi.
Well, no, their fate is left ambiguous. It's Joe Strummer, Alves, and then Steve Buscemi. They're all driving away because they think the cops are coming after them, and it's the cops are chasing somebody else.
Yeah, it's
so their fates are left open, and then you know that the
Japanese couple, the train that both the Japanese tourists and Nicoletta are on their way home, I guess, to go wherever.
Oh no, Nicoletta's not on that. Nicoletta
wasn't
on that train.
I could have sworn she was on that train. Did she ask them for?
No, she ended up going to the airport. You saw her at the airport, and then you heard final flight to Rome from Memphis, and she's just running down the terminal.
But somebody asked them for something, and they just gave her a light. They gave somebody a light, a match.
Oh, it was the other girl. They said,
oh, that's right. That's right. Okay, that was Dee Dee, right?
Yeah, it was Dee Dee. She said, do you know if this train's going to Natchez?
Is this going to Natchez? And then they give her a light because they think she's saying matches.
Matches, yes.
So that is it. I really did enjoy these movies. It's a nice change of pace away from all the gore.
It was different. I'm not a big Jim Jarmusch guy. I really never have been, but from what I have seen in these movies, I know he is a very talented filmmaker. He can take a low budget and make your movie look phenomenal. The only thing I think he lacks is, like, while I like his storytelling, it can be a little too disjointed at times, mm-hmm. and then he needs a little more on the resolution side of things. But if that's the type of filmmaker he wants to be, let it be written, so let it be done.
All right. I guess next time we're going to be doing The Stand, parts one. The new Stand series.
Yeah, we're just going to do a little overview of, like, our likes, our dislikes, our disagreements, and how we overall thought, because we'll just do this. We're going to talk about the differences between the original miniseries
and why the miniseries was better.
Yes, the original miniseries was better. Spoiler alert, the 94 miniseries was better. Having said that, you kind of should sort of watch this new one, but keep your expectations lowered.
Like, really low?
Like, really
psychotically low?
Yeah. Like, lower than low. The lowest of the low.
All right, don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. Or...
about damn time.
And thanks for tuning in. Good night.
Good night, everybody. In a big old tomb.